Hey guys, we're back. This is Trisha Gum, basically writer, director, art department, producer. I mean, this lady has done any wacky type of script you have with stop motion characters. Last thing she worked, or the thing you're working on presently right now, is a sequel to Lego Movie.
That's true.
You're also working. I've worked on Robot Chicken. Let's name off a few while you're there.
I've worked on the Lego Batman movie most recently. Co-directing right now on Lego 2. Came from stop motion, where I worked on stop motion TV shows like Tumbleleaf, which is a show for young children. Very beautiful show. Robot Chicken and Frankenhole. And then various other music videos and commercials.
There is one thing I have to bring up that's on your Vimeo.
Yeah.
Losing Ferguson.
Yeah.
I thought this was a really interesting little thing of, describe it for me.
So Losing Ferguson was my film that I did through a program called AFI Directing Workshop for Women.
Okay.
And it's an amazing program where women in the industry who want to transition into directing and writing are welcome to apply. And they pick 8 women every year, and you go through AFI, like a short workshop program, where you workshop a short film, and then you produce the short film at the end, you write it and direct it. And I was art directing on Robot Chicken, and I really wanted to transition into writing and directing, and so I applied for the program, and I got in with my script called Losing Ferguson, which is a live action, it's got some animation in it, but it's mostly a live action story about a girl whose imaginary friend breaks up with her because she's a little too old to have an imaginary friend, so he leaves her. And it's all about her journey and how she has to heal. You know, the whole reason she brought him back to life is because she was going through some trauma, and so she has to heal on her own without the crutch of her imaginary friend. But since it's all live action, there was no animation within the film itself. The live action, or the imaginary friend character, was a guy in a big giant mascot costume. And it was actually my brother, who's an actor, was in the big giant costume. And it was basically what a little girl's imagination would be, which was a half rabbit, half raccoon person in a mascot costume.
So, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to say like what the character was, but I was like, was it a dog? Was it a raccoon?
Half rabbit, half raccoon, duh. No. So it was two cute animals morphed into one, and that's like from a little girl's imagination. So.
But before that, you were working on Robot Chicken.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What were you doing on there?
So there I was the art director on Robot Chicken. So I was art directing. I was also writing and on the side, writing and directing little projects on the side. So.
Which led you into Ferguson.
Yeah, which led me to Losing Ferguson.
Basically, you just, you kind of saw a goal that you kind of wanted to check off, or
yeah.
How'd that work?
I just knew that I wanted to write and direct, and I knew I had a lot of stories that I wanted to tell, and that was one of them. And I knew I always wanted to make a film about a girl who's too old to have an imaginary friend and what would happen if he left her. So that was just like one of the stories I had, and I was like, well, maybe this program would catapult me to the next level, which it did.
In your past, you were mostly the art department part, mm-hmm. And then you were just saying you could do something different. I mean, as far as like other people can, identify with that,
yeah.
Having these goals, it's a very daunting thing.
Yeah.
To do.
I think it's because I knew what I wanted to do when I went to film school. I knew I wanted to write and direct. And when you first start out in the industry, you don't go from intern to writer-director. So I knew that my skill set was, I was an artist, and I knew I had a strong artistic vision. So I started out in the art department, but I knew ultimately my goal was to write and direct my own stories. So that's why my day job was, working in the art department and being an art director on different TV shows and commercials and stuff. But when I wasn't at work, I was taking writing classes and I was making my own little short films with my friends and just trying to figure out, like, how do I become a writer director and what can I show and how can I become better at being a storyteller? So it was really like a lot of my own time I was putting into perfecting, having people take me seriously as like a creator, a writer, director. and then trusting me with more and more things. Eventually, I became the assistant director on Robot Chicken. So I went from art director and then to assistant director because I'd worked there for a while, and the creators and the producers and the writers and directors all believed in me, and they were fantastic mentors, and they knew that I wanted to eventually direct, so they let me be the assistant director the following seasons. And then, yeah, just started just really snowballing from there, really trying to get good at it, because it's something, you know, I had to, like, learn from other people and learn from classes and things like that.
Work on the Lego Batman movie. Mm-hmm. You've really got to push story with character, I think. Can you talk a little more about that?
So Chris McKay was the director of that, of Lego Batman, and he was a mentor of mine and always a big supporter of mine. He was the director on Robot Chicken for a lot of the seasons I was there. And, you know, he really just believed in me to help him figure out how to make his vision of the story he wanted to tell come to life. So, you know, he's very open to hearing a lot of suggestions, and he wanted to make a story that was emotional and a story that people could connect to and characters that were very real. So, you know, he always wanted to brainstorm with us and push us to help him make a kind of film that really resonated with audiences.
Working with Legos, you're kind of limited on expression sometimes. Mm-hmm. And as far as your job goes, you're seeing the overall picture instead of, you know, some animators who are just worried about the face. You're overseeing everything, the timing, you know, and everything, the lighting, you know. How do you, like, tell the story with that? You know, how are you keeping the story beats in your head, you know?
Yeah, well, that's actually a really good question, because our animators are amazing. They're so fantastic that they can get so much emotion or comedy out of these tiny little figures that are basically just dots for eyes, and their arms can't move in all the articulation that ours can. So they're amazing at what they do. But a big part of what, you know, Chris would do as a director, and then, you know, he would have me kind of, like, really learning, is when you're looking at shots, an animator might present you with a shot where the character in the foreground is doing something really emotional, and the characters in the background are doing something really funny, and it might be distracting sometimes from the emotion that's going on in the character that's in the foreground, or vice versa. You know, sometimes the comedy in the background is more important than what's going on in the foreground. So it really is just, like, understanding overall the picture of, well, is this a moment in the overall story where we want to be quiet and have it be emotional, or is this a story point in the overall movie where we want it to be wacky and funny, and it's okay that there's all these distracting, crazy things happening in the background? So sometimes an animator would do something that was hilarious, but because the scene was emotional and had to be quiet, we couldn't use the idea, or we would have to say, that idea's great, bump it to the next scene where everything's wacky. You know, so you just have to think of the overall movie, like what's servicing the overall movie.
Today you showed off some deleted scenes from the movie. Mm-hmm. Some amazing, hilarious scenes. How do you take this machete, you know, to some of these parts that are just like...
Yeah. This term might be morbid, so you probably don't want to use it, but we always...
Well, I already said machete, so I brought it out there.
Third wine's worth, probably, but this is the term we actually use. You go, sometimes you have to drown some of your babies, and that's just what we say when it's just like, you love this idea, it's so funny, you want it to be in the movie, but ultimately it'll be distracting to what's actually going on. So, you know, there's so many talented people on the team, so of course you're just going to get a plethora of great ideas, and it really is just like focusing in on what's important to the story, either comedy-wise or emotion, because ultimately if you had everything in there, the story wouldn't come out as strong, because then people would go, well, some of it was good, but then other things went off on tangents, and it was kind of confusing to follow. So even though things are really funny and entertaining, sometimes you just have to let them go and hope that someday they end up somewhere else, or I can show them to an audience who's entertained to them by them, you know.
You really notice that, especially with Lego Batman, this new renaissance of these really funny films having great messages in them. I mean, I'm not even talking about family-friendly messages, just you can really understand the story. There is actually a story. It's not just things happening for funny sake anymore. And I applaud you basically just for being a part of that, you know, just giving both something that parents can watch with their kids and everyone gets something out of it, you know. So I applaud you for that and doing even more, you know, it sounds like with the sequels coming, you know. Yeah. And, so thank you again, Trisha Gum, for being here.
Thank you.